Good morning, everyone. Welcome back. I am so impressed that so many showed up on day two after the very intense and amazingly thought-provoking day we had yesterday. I imagine many of you went home with the same head-spinning feeling that I went home with. And the fact that somehow we were able to digest, maybe that's an overstatement, what happened yesterday and be back for more is great. It's fantastic. I want to take the opportunity to thank our sponsors again, Blackboard, Kaplan, and Learning House for helping us and make this possible. I also want to let you know that in April, our students are planning a TEDx event that will focus also on many of the issues we've been discussing, and you'll get more information about that. I want to thank everybody who's been part of this event and making it happen. Obviously, beginning with the provost who has been the leading force behind the effort, but also all the faculty members, the committee that put the event together. Some of them will later be on the closing panel, but not all of them will be. And I want you to know that a lot of people, this has been a true team effort of getting this together. And I appreciate the work of every single person who's been involved. And of course, our event planning team, they've done a terrific job. All these guys in the black shirts, or blue, as I see today, they've done a terrific job. Thank you guys. This has been a fantastic production. Can't wait to see the tapes and the videos. So thank you. One last logistics issue is that we're going to be trying to finish a little earlier. We recognize it's Saturday. Our brains are still a little bit tired from yesterday's exercise. So I think we're going to try to compress the timing a little bit, which I thought people will appreciate. Just a couple of thoughts. One is, I don't know if, since it happened towards the end of the day, I don't know if people realize this, but I went home and I double-checked, and it was true, that our hashtag, Mason Future, was trending worldwide on Twitter for about an hour in the evening. And I thought that was incredibly meaningful because, obviously, there's a little bit of pride there that a discussion we're having in our university here is being listened to by people around the world. But then what I thought is what it means, the fact that this conversation was trending worldwide, what it means is people around the world have a huge interest in these discussions, and that's a very good sign. I was reminded of Michele, who yesterday gave us a little preview of a survey that is not public yet, that will be rolled out next week, I believe, by the World Economic Forum. These guys really have in their network the top leaders in business and government and academia and NGOs literally in the world. I've worked with them for a number of years. And they asked him, what are the things that worry them? And what's amazing about the results that you will see and that he mentioned yesterday is that access to education, issues around education, is one of the very top trends that are considered as, what was the word, underestimated trends, trends that really ought to capture more attention in the global agenda. And not only that, but it's a new one. It's a new entrant in that top category. So the fact that our little discussion here is being listened to and followed from places around the world, the fact that the top leaders of organizations around the world are now reaching that consensus means this is a hugely relevant and important conversation needs to happen. And I'm delighted that we're part of that and driving in part that conversation. So those are just some thoughts. I wish as another sort of half day of open-mindedness. It was fantastic yesterday to be following not only the conversations in the room, but also the conversations that were happening on Twitter. And in fact, some of the questions that were asked that to some people appear a little hostile towards change, I actually thought they were exactly the kind of reaction you want to happen in a conversation like this. It is painful to contemplate things that are happening that maybe we're not yet part of. Some of those we are, some of those we're driving, others, and it is painful. So I think the expression of that pain in the form of, wait a second, I think that's a very good sign that that's happening. But I still want to remind us that what I would love for each of us to do, that's what I'm trying to do, is to think throughout the rest of the day about preconceived notions that we came with that we are now questioning. I thought A, and now I am not sure about A. I believe deeply X, and now I believe that X may not be true. So what I'm trying to do myself, and if it serves as a request for everybody, that we don't use an opportunity to reinforce our arguments, to find more reasons to entrench ourselves into the truths that we believe to be so, but can we figure out, wow, this actually is a valid question to a deeply rooted belief that I came in with. That's what I'm trying to do. What is it that I believed before these 2 days that I'm not sure about, or that even I might be willing to reject in my mind? That's the exercise I'm trying to go to. So anyway, let the fun restart. We're up for a great treat, and my colleague Janet is going to introduce our plenary speaker. Thank you so much.
Good morning. When we were putting together all of these 2 days of wonderful events, we decided that we really needed to have some perspective from what some of the foundations were thinking about. So we were delighted that when we started looking out at who might be possible to join us, that we were able to attract the Gates Foundation. The Gates Foundation, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, is guided by the belief that every life has equal value, that they help people around the world with poverty and health issues, and in this, you know, in the United States, they are focused on helping ensure that all people, especially those with the fewest resources, have access to opportunities that will help them be successful in school and in life. Suzanne Walsh is a senior program officer at the Gates Foundation, where she leads the foundation's development around education and institutional redesign strategies. Before joining the Gates Foundation, she was with the Lumina Foundation, where she managed the Making Opportunity Affordable initiative, which was aimed at increasing college productivity by bringing about fundamental change in the way higher education does business. So we're very delighted that Suzanne is able to join us today. Please join me in welcoming her. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I actually, I need to update my bio, because actually the most exciting thing that I've done recently is I was a judge for Dance Your PhD. And Google it. It's so fun. Those of you who are doctoral candidates, consider it, especially if you're in the sciences. It's like my favorite thing that I've done lately. The U is missing. But anyway, I hate data, and so can you. And why did I say that? Because we're not exactly known at the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation for hating data, right? We're actually known for being obsessed, in fact, with data. Are you amening me? Yeah. And so I, however, don't love spreadsheets. Do not love them. And so when I'm talking about data and saying that I hate data, it's that I hate raw data. And, you know, at the Gates Foundation, these are sort of the things that drive us. All lives have equal value. Every person deserves a chance to lead a healthy and productive life. If you listen to NPR, you heard that second one this morning. And education provides a pathway to possibilities. That's what's really, you know, that's sort of what's guiding our conversation today. It's actually all three of these things. And behind it, we always say we're data-driven. But what does that actually mean? Well, we have this larger goal on our post-secondary team, Effectively, we want most students who enter an institution of higher education to complete. That sounds easy, but even when I was looking at the completion rates for Mason, you're not necessarily at most in 4 years. You get there at 6 years, but you're not there at four. What's going on? What's behind those numbers? So what we're interested in is helping colleges and universities think about how they get to that most goal in the most efficient way. How do you get there quickly? Well, why do we care? Billions of dollars are being spent every year, both federal and state dollars, to help students to achieve those goals, help them to receive a degree. Millions of students aren't making it. That's a problem. How can we help most students to complete and to do it in a way that's both efficient for the student in terms of time and cost and efficient for institutions? We heard a lot yesterday, actually, about productivity. So our goals, this is a support group for data haters. And also, I want to just think together about how can we use data to make better and different decisions. And I'm also really interested in hearing about the ways that you actually are using data in ways that you find to be productive. And not just those of you who are data geeks, because you always love data. But for those of you who've done the thing that the president asked us to do, which is to actually change our thinking over time. And so I just wanted to start out with a little poll. It'll take a minute to load. So this is some software that, especially if you're faculty, I love using this. It's free for most of you because your class sizes aren't 700, I don't think. So this is called Poll Everywhere. And I just want to start off. This is our test question just to warm us up. You can use your cell phone. You can use your tablet, your computer. And the question is, do you prefer coffee or tea? I figured we were at kind of that level at this hour of the morning. It's 5 in the morning for me. So what you'll do is you'll text, the code is 22333. You put that in the 2 line or where you put somebody's name or the phone number, 22333. If you prefer tea, it's 29087. You put that in the part of the text where you would write a message. 29087 is tea, coffee, 260-399, neither 260-858. Oh, those coffee drinkers always get me. Who are the neither people? Do you drink Mountain Dew? Because that's what I keep hearing about. What are you drinking? What? Oh, that's nice. Anybody? Okay, that's your test. That was your warm-up. Now, just so I know who's in the room for my support group, I hate data. True, false, maybe. So the same, wow, okay, this is quite a group. You have the hang of it. In the back, do you need me to read the numbers? If it's true, so you're texting to 22333, 22333. And then if it's true, 603926. Oh, look at that. 603296. False, 927. 603927. I should not do bingo. I always transpose these numbers. False, 603928. Okay, that's a lot of falses. Wow, I'm impressed. Who are the people who are in the I hate data camp? Anybody willing to admit it? What do you hate?
What I'm hating mostly is that I'm so old school that
I've got a dumb phone and I'm not even sure I'm texting to the right number.
I like that. I had not thought of it. I'm going to add that to my remarks from now on. Anybody else who hates data that you're willing to admit it in front of your administration? So I also recognize there's a reason this is anonymous. All right, so turns out I'm mostly speaking to the converted. What about the maybes? What's a maybe? Why maybe?
I like receiving data. I don't like producing it.
Oh, nice. Anybody else in the maybe camp? Yeah. Is that the maybe table? Is that like your official table?
Yeah, right. This is the maybe table. Sometimes I think the data doesn't show what we're really trying to look at. There's been too many situations where people aren't asking the right question or people aren't understanding the question to provide the right answer.
That's great. Great. So here's why I'm talking about data. So this report came out last year, and it was Inside Higher Ed had this survey. So less than two-fifths of college presidents, provosts, and CFOs feel that their institution does a very effective job of using data to inform decision-making. So all of you who love data, what's going on? Why is it that there's this percentage of people who are not using it effectively? So one of the things that I think about when I think about data, and why does data, so I'm like you, I don't like it just raw data. I want somebody to start kind of helping me to make sense of it, because then I can use it quickly. I can go do something with it. So there's a company in Austin. It's a startup called Civitas Learning. And these bullets actually come from their website. This is sort of what they promise to do. And so I put them in this what if statement, because I think this is interesting. As you're trying to think about how you graduate more students more efficiently, what if we could, especially if you're a faculty or staff member, what if we could allow for real-time view of which students are at risk of dropping out and why? Real time, not, oh, I got it 3 semesters or 3 years later, but real time. What if we could identify specific courses and degree paths that may be contributing to attrition? What if we could reveal resources and interventions that are most successful and for which students? And what if we could provide a window into instructional techniques or curricular resources that are resonating best for students? Do you feel like you have those capabilities now? Some? What are the pieces that you have that are most effective from that list? Anybody? Are you out there? That's my go-to lady from now on, the red shirt, the red sweater lady. You're a morning person.
I think that the...
Thank you.
I think that the data I could generate most easily would be who's at risk of dropping out and why, but I'd be doing it by something that has nothing to do with data and a lot to do with instinct. So unless you call instinct all the data of observation and of the skills of having been a teacher for a long time, data, it isn't based on data. It's instinct. And whether that's more reliable is really very hard to say.
Well, I mean, I think that's what happens now is we do rely a lot on instinct, right? And we do, but we treat our instinct as if that was real data. And I think that that's a little bit of a challenge. The Twitter stream yesterday was fascinating to me on the community college thing. Wow, you guys blew up on that one. And what was so interesting was I had this exchange, and I don't know if Jeff is out there, but we had this exchange about how do you know, so there were a lot of assertions about community college students are not as prepared. They're not as prepared, they're not doing the same level of work that our students have done. How do you back that up? What's the data? Some of it's instinct, some of it's experience. Is that good enough? And how do you know how those students are actually doing in your class? What if you could look? So one of the things that Civitas is experimenting with right now is to say to a faculty member, when you look at your course roster, yes, you can see a bunch of names of students, you can see their grades, but what if you could actually see them in a color-coded way? Green, those students are totally on track. Red, oh my gosh, they are not on track at all. Yellow, if with some support, they could get on track. A different way of looking at that data. You may instinctively have a sense of who those students are. You may even kind of recognize it if you see their name. But what if it's a very quick look in terms of color coding and it's visual? Does that change the way that you interact with your class? Does it allow you to be much more nimble in terms of the way that you interact? Are you moving towards somebody who had their hand up?
Just in response to your earlier question, we're using... for the second year, a program called MapWorks that I think gives us at least some decent starts on data toward dealing with the first question at least, and hopefully then talking about some remedial responses.
And what do you think about, you know, I think that people are starting to get better at number one. I think a lot of folks are really, really struggling with that combination of courses, and I want to flip to this next screen because there's a question about what students have access to. As a student, again, it's a lot of instinct, right? You kind of talk to your peer group about which course combinations kind of work, which faculty members kind of work, but what if the students actually had access to this in an app? That's what Civitas is actually thinking about. So what if the students could see, am I on track, and what combinations of courses am I taking? There's sort of, it's a little bit of a version of the work that Purdue has been doing with their Signals project, but it's taking it to the next level. So part of this is also about ease of use and access. There are a lot of iPads out there. Why do you guys like your iPads? Easy is usually what people say. They're really easy to use. Things are right at your fingertips. You're not working that hard. That's what students and faculty really want in terms of how they use data. So the things that I really like about this idea that Civitas is playing with is also this last one about proactive recommendations about how to spend time during courses and which resources to use. This doesn't mean we are replacing student services. We are not replacing faculty advisors. It means that when you actually go to your advisor as a student, you have a lot more information. When you are an advisor, you have a lot more information more quickly. So one of the things that Civitas did is they actually sat with student services personnel for a lot of hours at one of the colleges. And one of the things that they discovered was most of the time they spent was doing what? Searching for information. Right, you spend a lot of time, I've got to find that file on that student, I have to look at this course schedule, what if you could actually start to get this information quickly and in one place? So why, I love this from Twitter, why in 2012 should we be exchanging spreadsheets to communicate data with each other? So a lot of times we all congratulate ourselves because we said, oh great, spreadsheet, I've given you that spreadsheet. That is not enough. There's this hierarchy of visual learning, and I'm going to come back to that. So I'm just going to wander behind the couches. What I love about this is it takes data and says, here's raw data. We call that data. It's just discrete. These are your spreadsheets. Once I start to contextualize it, that's making it into information. So I'm just going to keep kind of going up the pyramid. Then the next level is where I've actually started to interpret the data, interpret the information. That's knowledge. When I apply the knowledge, when I'm actually able to do something with it, that's wisdom. This is the pyramid you expect in your classrooms for those of you who are faculty. But this is also the pyramid that when I work with colleges, I expect faculty and administrators to be going through themselves. I expect for you to not just go around sharing spreadsheets, but I expect that you're actually contextualizing it, helping to make sense of it, helping people get to wisdom. How often do you feel like you're getting to wisdom? Do you feel like you get there often enough? Are there things that are missing that could help you get there? Here's a spreadsheet. And I know in the back you can see it. I love the title. This is the actual title, The Impact of University Tuition Fees, a Spreadsheet. As if that really mattered. I mean, I don't know. It's a spreadsheet that makes it sound like it's a blockbuster film. And I'm sure for those of you who are data, like, this is fabulous. This is great. Well, you know what? Wired Magazine had this great article about how people were using data related to HIV and AIDS. And so there was this big movement to open up the databases, make them transparent, and so forth. And it was very, very exciting for a lot of people, who were already using data. So the goal was to open it up to more people, but more people didn't use it. It was still in a format that wasn't useful to all. And so it just meant that the same people were using it over and over again. So this is another way to look at the tuition increases in the UK. Basically, that spreadsheet was starting to say, what does it cost a student to actually go to college? And by that, they meant loss of earnings, tuition and fees, additional costs. So this is another way to present an easy mathematical formula. Here's another way to think about it. The average student budget. Visual, breaks it at pizza money, now I know. Tuition and fees are represented there. So there are multiple ways of representing data. And the question for you is, for 2 days you've been talking about how to change this institution, how to push higher ed into the future. Well, you're not going to get there if you just do it sort of via spreadsheets. How do you start to make your case? How do you speak with others and bring them along in a way where the data actually is compelling, where it tells a story? So I want to actually run this video just to help provoke a few thoughts.
It feels like we're all suffering from information overload or data glut, and the good news is there might be an easy solution to that, and that's using our eyes more. So visualizing information so that we can see the patterns and connections that matter, and then designing that information so it makes more sense, or it tells a story, or allows us to focus only on the information that's important. Failing that, visualized information can just look really cool. So let's see. This is the billion-dollar-ogram, and this image arose out of frustration I had with the reporting of billion-dollar amounts in the press. That is, they're meaningless without context. 500 billion for this pipeline, 20 billion for this war. It doesn't make any sense. So the only way to understand it is visually and relatively. So I scraped a load of reported figures from various news outlets and then scaled the boxes according to those amounts. And the colors here represent the motivation behind the money. So purple is fighting, and red is giving money away, and green is profiteering. And what you can see straight away is you start to have a different relationship to the numbers. You can literally see them. But more importantly, you start to see patterns and connections between numbers that would otherwise be scattered across multiple news reports. Let me point out some that I really like. This is OPEC's revenue, this green box here, 780 billion a year. And this little pixel in the corner, 3 billion, that's their climate change fund. Americans, incredibly generous people, over 300 billion a year donated to charity every year, compared with the amount of foreign aid given by the top 17 industrialized nations at 120 billion. And then, of course, the Iraq war predicted to cost just 60 billion back in 2003, and the mushroom slightly Afghanistan and Iraq mushroom now to 3,000 billion. So, now, it's great, but now we have this texture and we can add numbers to it as well. So we can say, well, a new figure comes out, let's see, African debt. How much of this diagram do you think might be taken up by the debt that Africa owes to the West? Let's take a look. So there it is, 227 billion is what Africa owes. And the recent financial crisis, how much of this diagram might that figure take up? What does that cost the world? Let's take a look at that. Douche, which I think is the appropriate sound effect from that much money. 11,900 billion. So, by visualizing this information, we turned it into a landscape that you can explore with your eyes, a kind of map, really, a sort of information map. And when you're lost in information, an information map is kind of useful. So, I want to show you another landscape now. I need to imagine what a landscape of the world's fears might look like. Let's take a look. This is mountains out of molehills, a timeline of global media panic. So I'll label this for you in a second. But the height here I want to point out is the intensity of certain fears as reported in the media. Let me point them out. So this, swine flu, pink. Bird flu. SARS, brownish here. Remember that one? The millennium bug? Terrible disaster. These little green peaks are asteroid collisions. And in summer here, killer wasps. So these are what our fears look like over time in the media. But what I love, and I'm a journalist, and what I love is finding hidden patterns. I love being a data detective. And there's a very interesting and odd pattern hidden in this data that you can only see when you visualize it. Let me highlight it for you. See this line? This is a landscape for violent video games. As you can see, there's a kind of odd regular pattern in the data, twin peaks every year. If we look closer, we see those peaks occur at the same month every year. Why? Well, November, Christmas video games come out, and there may well be an upsurge in concern about their content. But April isn't a particularly massive month for video games. Why April? Well, in April 1999 was the Columbine shooting. And since then, that fear has been remembered by the media and echoes through the group mind gradually through the year. You have retrospectives, anniversaries, court cases, even copycat shootings, all pushing that fear into the agenda. And there's another pattern here as well. Can you spot it? See that gap there? There's a gap, and it affects all the other stories. Why is there a gap there? You see where it starts? September 2001, when we had something very real to be scared about. So I've been working as a data journalist for about a year, and I keep hearing a phrase all the time, which is this: data is the new oil. Now, data is a kind of ubiquitous resource that we can shape to provide new innovations and new insights, and it's all around us, and it can be mined very easily. And it's not a particularly great metaphor in these times, especially if you live around the Gulf of Mexico, but I would perhaps adapt this metaphor slightly, and I would say that data is the new soil. Because for me, it feels like a fertile, creative medium. You know, over the years, online, we've laid down a huge amount of information and data, and we irrigated it with networks and connectivity, and it's been worked and tilled by unpaid workers and governments. And all right, I'm kind of milking the metaphor a little bit, but it's a really fertile medium. And it feels like visualizations, infographics, data visualizations, they feel like flowers blooming from this medium. But if you look at it directly, it's just a load of numbers and disconnected facts. But if you start working with it and playing with it in a certain way, interesting things can appear and different patterns can be revealed. Let me show you this. Can you guess what this data set is?
Can you pause right there?
What rises twice a year?
So can you, I don't know if you can see that. Can you see the outlines of this? Yeah. What do you think this is? So there's... January, February, March, there's kind of a spike, there's a spike, there's a little spike here in sort of June, July, the end of the year. Any guesses about what's this representing? What rises and falls like that? Suicide? Other guesses? You have to yell at me.
Retail sales.
Retail sales. Anything else? You have to yell.
Candy consumption.
All right, I'm going to let it play. Go ahead. Sick days. You may need them.
And then 2 weeks before Christmas. Has a mini peak every Monday and then flattens out over the summer. I'll take answers. Chocolate. You might want to get some chocolate in. Any other guesses? Shopping. Retail therapy might help. Sick leave, yeah, you'll definitely want to take some time off. Shall we see?
You can stop it right there. So the reason that I go through this video and the reason that I really like it is because it forces you to start thinking about data in a different way. I could have told you when the breakups are on Facebook. I could have just given you numbers. I could have given you months. Does it have the same impact? Does it have the same impact when you're able to sort of look at a pattern and discern it for yourself? It causes you to come up with your own hypotheses. You all didn't have the same hypothesis. You each had a different way of looking at it. And I think that's what's so important about the data. And as the president said earlier, you know, he talked about the importance of being open to new possibilities. That's what data looked at in a way that's not just spreadsheets can help you do, in a way that helps you to get to patterns. So again, this company that I've been talking about today, Civitas, what's so interesting is this is part of what they think is really important. If we can have such great recommendation engines for eHarmony, Facebook, and I have a colleague actually who got married based on eHarmony. We can all talk about that later. It's a lot of work. Actually, let me pause. It is a lot of work. That's what I learned with eHarmony. eHarmony, you fill in all the information. It's like being a student. You give all the information. They have an entire record of you. But you actually have essay questions to respond to. There's like homework to do. This is a commitment. But anyway, but they have an algorithm behind it that helps to make those matches, obviously. Facebook, Amazon, et cetera. If those sort of technologies are available for making the right matches, for helping people to have sort of better life experiences, why don't we have that same kind of thing in higher education? All of the dreams that you guys have put on the table, you know, yesterday and what I'm sure we'll hear about today, they won't matter if you don't have the right sort of data behind it, if you don't have the right way of analyzing the data behind it. And Don Norris is somewhere in here, and he can really talk to you about the importance of data analytics, because that's what's behind all of this. Really critical time for data. And you guys have some great programs here at Mason. So how are you using your data mining folks and some of your visual artists to be able to help you as an institution, not just help to create future graduates? So ultimately, if you want to make a difference with data, you have to start with some sort of an idea. Can you explain it in a new way or a more interesting way? And the reason that I put that there is because there's a department chair in Portland who talks about his faculty are always asking for data, 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 because we've finally, you know, everybody knows we're going to be data-driven. But now his thing is, I'm not giving you the data unless you can talk about how you're going to use it. How are you going to use it in a different way? It's not enough to just say, I want data. And you have to be open to discovery. You also have to be willing to let things go. So just again, as President Cabrera said, you cannot start out just with an opinion and just go looking for data to support your opinion.
There was laughter in the front row. Apparently, you've heard people do that. You wouldn't have done that yourself. And but it's a challenge in dealing with students as well, because you have an instinct about how you think students will react. You have an instinct about how they'll behave. What happens if you look at the data in a fresh way? One of the things that we've done through a project that we have called Completion by Design is we asked these are community colleges, and we asked them to look at their data in a new way. They had always looked at it in the most traditional ways. How do we disaggregate by gender and race and age? That tells you a certain set of things. But when we started to look at their transcripts, so we started to say, okay, so if a student claims to be a major in, let's say, history, since that seems to be the hot major here, if I'm a history major, does my course-taking behavior actually support that? Not always. And so what we saw was that there are students who have 30 credits or more, have been enrolled for 5 years, let me give you a hint, 30 credits, you're halfway through an associate's degree, 30 credits or more, enrolled for 5 years, nowhere near a degree. Because their course-taking patterns showed something else. But if I just looked at the data on those students, I might have come up with a different response. How do you start looking for patterns? You have to be willing to let things go. You don't have to tell the entire story of a student. You don't have to tell the entire story of an institution. Try to focus on the things that are most interesting, most valuable to leading to bigger, better decisions. Honesty and humility is critical, and trust. It's not going to help if you don't trust the data or the data sources. It's not going to help if you can't let go of your own egos. Sometimes the data tells you things that you don't want to hear. You have to be open to that. So ultimately, why do we care about data? Well, it helps to improve the lives of students. It helps to improve those completion rates. We are particularly interested in low-income students. And so at an institutional level, what needs to happen? A commitment to completion, use of data to drive change, and support of faculty-led innovation. There was a lot of great ideas. There are a lot of great ideas up here. How are you capturing that? How are you sharing that data back, not in spreadsheets? How are you telling the stories? And how do you increase productivity? So the last thing that I'll just say in thinking about data is there's a student in Portland, who community college student, and she was in the same remedial math class. She had taken it five times, failed five times. So that's one data point. However, when you start asking questions about what's going on. Turns out, same faculty member, all five times. Maybe there's a message. Start digging a little bit more deeply into that, and also you understand, you think, well, maybe she's just not good. Maybe she doesn't like numbers. She was a cashier, and this was before everything was computerized. So, you know, the question is, once you start digging in and you understand, this student isn't afraid of math. She's got some kind of grit or tenacity. Maybe it was the faculty member. How can you start to uncover the right patterns to help students to be more successful? And so I really think that, again, together we can get there. We can get there as long as we start to ask different questions of the data, as long as we are open to asking those questions, open to receiving that new information. Together, we can actually help to get to that goal of most students who enter an institution of higher education completing. Thank you so much.